Good evening. This is Kaleem Shabazz, the president of the Atlantic City branch of the NAACP, welcoming you to our Election Day edition of your NAACP Speaks. Today is Election Day all over America. If you have not, for any reason, you've not voted, you still have three options to vote before 8 o'clock this evening. Number one, if you have not filled out your ballot, you can fill it out and take it to a secure mailbox. In Atlantic City, it's between City Hall and the county building. In Pleasantville, it's outside the municipal building. And if you go on the NAACP website, we have a list of the other secure mailboxes throughout the county. And these boxes are secure, they are monitored. You have up until 8 o'clock today, you can fill out and put your completed ballot in there. By 8 o'clock today, if you do that tonight, your ballot will be counted. You can take your ballot to the county clerk's office in Mays Landing, and you can deposit it there in the clerk's office in Mays Landing before 8 o'clock. Or you can take your ballot, if it's unfilled, and hand it in at a polling place in your district, or you can vote provisional. Provisional means you have to vote by hand, it will be secured, and you hand it in to the election supervisor at that polling site. Those are the three options you have, but you must exercise one of those three options by 8 p.m. today if you have not already voted. If you've already voted, we thank you for voting. Again, today is Election Day, and we hope everyone exercises their right to vote. As we do every week, we salute President Hawks, the leader and founder of WHA, and our super engineering staff, Super Steph and Brother Terran. Also, sad duty again this week, as we've done for many weeks since March, since the virus has spread. We pray for all of the families afflicted whose members have succumbed to COVID-19 in New Jersey, over 16,000 and over 225,000 across our great country. We mourn each and every loss, and we pray for the strength of the families, and we pray for the day that a vaccine will be found and implemented and safely distributed to people across the country. We are heard every Tuesday at 4:30 here on WEHA 88.7, 100.3 FM, your NAACP Speaks. And we talk as those of you who have tuned in before, you know, from the 4:30 to 5 o'clock hour, we talk about issues, events. Our very distinguished and articulate co-host, Yolanda Melville Esquire, gives us announcements, mistreats me on the guest count, and we have a weekly challenge that we do that. But we salute our studio audience and all of you who took time out to listen. Before we turn it over to our very esteemed co-host, let me just again encourage you, if for whatever reason you haven't voted, please vote today. 8 o'clock is your deadline. We need everyone to vote. As you know, the NAACP is a nonpartisan civil rights and social justice organization. But we don't tell people who to vote for or how to vote. We don't endorse candidates, but we feel that you must vote. With the climate in the White House that is so anti people of color, I think it should be clear to you how you should vote, but vote your conscience. And you have to do that before 8 o'clock. Without further ado, I want to turn it over to our very articulate and eloquent and esteemed national president of the Next Gen Leadership Program, the NAACP, our legal redress officer for the Atlantic City branch of the NAACP, Yolanda Melville Esquire. Good afternoon, Yolanda.
Good afternoon, President. I just want to just start off by saying thank you. Mm-hmm. We have gone through this election cycle. We've been doing this all year, as we know that there's an election every year. We vote every year. But this one has been special because of the amount of effort that this branch has put forth, the branch members, but also you as well as being our leader. So I do want to tell you thank you.
Thank you.
I want to tell our membership thank you. I want to tell WEHA thank you for giving us this platform to talk to the community over the last year and really inform the public about how to vote amongst other issues as well. But this has been a platform that many have listened to. I've heard from others across our community who have listened to us on the show and have heard the information that we spread, particularly about the enfranchisement of those who are formerly incarcerated, from changing the time in which you are registered to vote, how to register to vote, and obviously now today, how to vote on election day. So all this information has been useful. It's important, but we wanted to salute the foot soldiers, WEHA and the NAACP, and you as our esteemed president for putting forth the effort and the opportunity for us to tell more people in the community, not just our membership.
Thank you. Thank you.
I also want to thank a number of people who are coalition members who have helped us over the last year. So first, I want to thank Building One America, Paul Scully, for his work with us here in the 2nd Congressional District, because it's not just about Atlantic City NAACP, it's the coalition building, so we all can lift our voices up throughout our South Jersey communities. I want to thank the Masons for being steadfast foot soldiers with us in coalition, and the GOTV efforts over the past year have been no different, but we've been working on that partnership for many, many years. Delta Sigma Theta, the Lynx Incorporated, Avanzar, who has been particularly important in this particular election because of the work that they're doing on the ground. They've been putting out pens, blue pens, to make sure that people are filling out their ballots correctly and with the right pen, because you have to use blue or black ink in order to effectuate your ballot. Zeta Phi Beta Sorority, Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority, St. James AME Church, who, even if we were not in a pandemic, they would definitely be top five on our list as coalition partners who have availed their facility, their church, to us for having many, many programs. And even though we are in a pandemic and doing everything virtually, their membership has been particularly active in making sure we get out the vote this election season. And Second Baptist Church as well, with Reverend Colin Days and Mandy Constance Days Chapman, who is our infant mortality and maternal health task force chair, but also just a steward of making sure over 200 young people in our community have been registered to vote over the last year. And even though they're not in the district, I'll give a special shout out to Pastor Francois and Mount Zion Baptist Church in Pleasantville. Well, it's election day. Well, here we are. And I want to first tell everybody that even though it's election day, you still need to be registered to vote if you have not voted. Although you're not eligible to vote in this particular November 3rd election, there are many, many, many elections in the future, including a gubernatorial election next year that you particularly need to be active in. And how to do that? This is election day, but still people can get registered to vote. You have to be a United States citizen, at least 17 years of age, although you have to be 18 years old to register, to vote. You have to be a resident of your county for 30 days before that election. And so long as you're not incarcerated or someone you know is not incarcerated, they are eligible to vote. And you have to be registered at least 21 days before the next election. I also want to remind people the importance of NAACP membership. We've seen over the last year social justice and civil unrest in our communities, and the foot soldiers who are doing that work for free are members of the NAACP. And so we need to find resources to support them, but also to support our local efforts as well. And here, to be an NAACP member for the Atlantic City branch, you can do it two ways. You can send a check to our PO Box at 1182, PO Box 1182, Absecon, New Jersey 08201, And you can always go online to naacp.org/become a member. And you click search, type in 08401, and we are unit number 2077B for Atlantic City. And a 1-year membership for an adult is $30. But we have many, many youth memberships available. So if you would like to get more involved, or you have a young person who wants to get more involved in the NAACP, please make sure that they contact us at our email address or our social media. And I do want to remind people about a national event. Election 2020, the reckoning tonight, November 3rd. Coverage starts at 7 p.m. on the National NAACP's YouTube and Facebook pages. And this is going to be a phenomenal group of panelists, our president and CEO nationally, Derek Johnson, as well as journalist Ed Gordon. We have Michael Eric Dyson. We have Brittany Cooper, Aisha Mills, Mark Thompson, and Jamel Hill. So there'll be a robust amount of information that comes from this dynamic panel tonight starts at 7 p.m. But we also have another event, a virtual town hall starting tomorrow, November 3rd, which is Wednesday. And that will also be previewed on the NAACP's YouTube and Facebook pages. So please make sure you tune in to the NAACP nationally to what is going to be informative. Even though the election is coming to a close, there's so much information that needs to be submitted around the country about voter protection and social justice issues that we're having. So please tune in 7 p.m. tonight or tomorrow at the NAACP Nationals Facebook and YouTube pages. Also, we keep the party going here in Atlantic City. We'll be having a Zoom called Racism and America's Tomorrow, which will be Thursday, November 5th, 2020, starting at 7 p.m. and participating is none other than our own president, Kaleem Shabazz, here at the Atlantic City NAACP, and Bill Subin of Beth Israel Synagogue. So Thursday, November 5th, 7 p.m., and we will post the details on how to register for that Zoom on our Facebook page and our social media platforms. I do want to, I think that's it for all of my announcements for today. I'm used to telling people about how to vote and the census, but you know, we have a panoply of new issues coming up over the next couple of months. And one thing we're gonna please stay tuned for is our Youth Leadership Institute and our announcement about future opportunities that we have with Stockton University. So that will be coming up very soon. So that's a sneak preview. And I think we'll turn it over to you, President.
Okay. Thank you, Yolanda. Let me just add two churches to the thank yous. I join you, all the people, all the groups that you thank. They were and remain partners. There is going to be an election next year, very robust next year, a gubernatorial, state senators, assembly is going to be up, freeholders, and there are going to be municipal elections. So we're going to continue doing what we do. Let me just make an announcement. The Code Drive in Atlantic City at Turning Point, which happens to be an institution in my council district, they have been collecting coats for the needy. And I must report to you that after the last announcement, the director, Ms. Lewis, reported to me that several people came forth with coats. In fact, she said a gentleman brought 30 new coats to them for people who needed it. And that was very, very much appreciated. So Turning Point is in Atlantic City. For those of you who have coats that you don't have use for, gently used or new coats, I don't have to tell this audience that you wouldn't give somebody something that you wouldn't wear, because our audience is not like that. So please, if you have a coat or coats, please give them to Turning Point. And there are several people in our community who need those coats, and they would be very appreciative. Also, let me say, Yolanda, that we are very concerned about the COVID-19 virus spread that's happening all over the country. And right here in Atlantic City, I can report to the audience that Atlantic City cases are creeping up, unfortunately. I know people in my council district who unfortunately have succumbed to COVID-19 and passed away. Families who are hit by COVID-19 as we speak. People who don't have the luxury to work from home, who don't have white collar jobs or technical jobs, they have to be frontline people, and they are very anxious and concerned for number one, their exposure, and then number two, their family's exposure, and then even number three, if they have family members with underlying conditions that put them in a precarious position. And then you couple that, Yolanda, with people who are in intergenerational homes, don't have the room to quarantine, to segregate people off so that people can be in a separate facility, a separate room. Most people just don't have that many rooms in their house. And so it's a serious situation. We are concerned as a civil rights organization because health is a civil right. The health disparity is a social injustice, and it's magnified by the virus. As Dr. Washington, who was our guest a couple of weeks ago, really talked about, he gave us a seminar on public health. So we encourage people, please get your flu shot. The flu season is coming rapidly upon us. So if you put the flu together with the virus and all the other conditions that we mentioned, many of our audience are at risk for the virus. And we're not trying to scare anybody, we're trying to give people facts. So please get your flu shot. Flu shots are available at the through the county. And if you have insurance, obviously, you can go to your doctor. If your doctor doesn't have it, you can go to Walgreens and they have free flu shots if you have insurance. But it's very, very important that you get your flu shot. Despite what the president says about firing Dr. Fauci, Dr. Fauci is giving the country correct public health information, just like Dr. Washington here on the local level gave us. And also Dr. Washington at our NAACP meeting did that. I wanted to mention, Yolanda, Jeffro Memorial Church, which we thank under the leadership of Reverend Marion McLaughlin. We meet there when we were having in-person meetings, we really can't say enough about the community service that Jeffro does. If they charged us for the service that they give us and for the use that we make of their facility, we couldn't afford to pay them. So we want to thank Jeffro for what they've done over the years. And also Reverend Elias Thomas, who is the senior pastor at Community Baptist Church. We met there for the last 2 months in an outdoor meeting in the parking lot because they have a spacious parking lot there and we can social distance and we can meet. So I wanna thank Reverend Thomas for opening his doors, allowing us to use his chairs and being a community partner. And we might try to squeeze the November meeting in there. I understand that it's supposed to be 70 degrees, so we'll see. But thank you. I wanted to add those two to your list, Yolanda, of partners. We have a lot of community partners for the NAACP. I'm happy to report, and we thank and value all of them.
Yes, thank you, President. And I also want to, before we move off of voting particularly, say best of luck to all of our candidates. So we've had an opportunity to have candidates forums and get to know each one of our current elected officials and those who are actually running for office this election season. And we want to send well wishes to all of them. Do not be a stranger to the NAACP. Many of them are already members of the NAACP. So we encourage anyone who is wants to know more about their community and is passionate about the issues, meet us at the NAACP and we'll be glad to make you a member as well. So good luck to our candidates this election season.
I join you in that. It takes a lot of fortitude to run for public office, especially today. And you're right, all of the candidates on both sides of the aisle are to be congratulated and best wishes to all of them. Many of them are members of the NAACP. I just wanted to say that. And many of them were members of the NAACP before they decided to run for office. They just didn't do that as a part of running for office. And I wanted to say that and highlight them. And just a quick word about Mandy. Mandy took the lead and kept the lead in the very successful membership drive that we had. We always have a membership drive, but we had a special one during the summer, and we'll be announcing very shortly the prize that she got. Although she didn't do it for the prize, she did it because she wanted to do it, and she is a very active and productive member of the branch. But she did lead, and she she set a pace for everyone, and we were very successful. And let me just give a teaser, Yolanda. We're going to be in the coming weeks announcing our Martin Luther King Day activities. It's going to have to be a change from what we normally do. But Dr. Washington has said that we can have successfully a march, a socially distancing, a walk, and we're going to be, he doesn't know it, but I'm going to ask him to help us be the marshal and make sure that we have correct social distancing along with some of our next gen youth representatives. And we're going to have a very special speaker for our program this year, a next gen leader from Red Bank, I believe.
Yes.
And it's going to be excellent. And also an extra special feature this year that you're going to be hearing more about is our NAACP Radiothon, which is going to be on Martin Luther King's Day. And we're going to attempt to raise funds for the Atlantic branch. As you know, we couldn't have our fundraiser because of COVID-19. And the way it's going, I don't think we'll be able to have it this year in April, despite what the president says. I listened to Dr. Fauci, and I think that he has correctly said that we're going to be most of 2021 still dealing with this virus. So we're going to have a radiothon, and we're going to have speakers. We're going to ask you for money to help the NAACP in our fight for civil rights and social justice. We're going to have some poetry. Yolanda, I threatened to sing, but people said, no, you better not do that. So I won't sing, but we'll have guests and people in civil rights, social justice, government, politics, labor, to come in and encourage the community to support us. So you'll be hearing more about that. That'll be after the program. We'll have the walk. We'll have let people go back to their houses. They'll hear the virtual address, and then we'll go right into our program on the radiothon. And Yolanda, in addition, the audience should know that the radiothon will mark our 1 year anniversary on WEHA NAACP Speaks, because last year, the day after Martin Luther King's Day, we started our first program. It doesn't seem like it. It seemed like it was only yesterday. Time has flown so fast, but we're rapidly approaching that.
Well, this is a very important year. At that time that we did not know we were going to be facing, but certainly this platform has created an opportunity for us to disseminate information. And I will say, as I heard you talking, President, I was thinking about, we always ask for membership and money, right? So I want to just highlight a few of the things that we've been able to accomplish over the last year. As you know, many of us, all of us are volunteers for the NAACP. We don't get paid for what we do, but certainly there's a cost because we need resources to do it. So just this election season alone, from the primary, which was July, to now, on our voter registration efforts, we, amongst others in our coalition efforts with Building One America, have done over 10,000 phone calls to people within our congressional district to remind them, African-American voters, to remind them they should get out to vote. And that was just from July to now. We've sent thousands of text messages. Some have come from you, some have come from me, among other civil rights leaders in our community. We've also done virtual parties. So we talked about Constance Stace Chapman and her, right, her steadfast leadership in getting memberships, but she's also been instrumental in making sure that we connect with our young adults and our young voters who may not be in the places we typically find them, but we do find them on social media. So having these virtual parties where we put a little music on, but then still remind people about the importance of voting and the census has been pivotal to making sure we reach new audiences. Of course, our program here every Tuesday has been phenomenal, again, to reach a different demographic. One, that intergenerational approach to we're talking about, being in a household where we might meet a grandmother and a grandchild where their access to information may be two different mediums, right? Forums, we've had forums, we've had candidates nights. We've done a lot of things virtually, even though we've probably seen each other a handful of times in person. There have been opportunities after opportunities for us to engage with our community, even within a pandemic, because it was necessary. People were disconnected and people were looking for ways to do more because they saw what was happening outside their doors and they were encountering that within their families. So we have been very active and we need, there's so much more that we can do. We have not even touched the surface when it comes to infant mortality and maternal health, youth, economic empowerment, climate justice, environmental justice, housing. There are so many different ways that the NAACP can do more in our community, which means we need more people. So I just wanted to highlight those things as I was hearing you talk.
Right, you're right. And also we've done three forms on police reform.
That's right.
We just did one in conjunction with the Coalition for a Safe Community, where we had Major Brian Polite from the State Police. We had Matthew Lattimore from the Justice Department, and we had Chief Sarkis from Atlantic City Police, and two of our young people, Irvin Marino Rodriguez and Tyree Robinson. And they, from the perspective of young men and their involvement with law enforcement, that was one of the panels we did. We also did a panel with the prosecutor, Damon Tyner, talking about police reform. And for the third one, Yolanda, we're going to have a panel on November 19th. And we're going to have a representative from the Attorney General's office, Ms. Bryn Whittle, who's a Deputy Attorney General. We're going to have the chief from Pleasantville, Chief Riggins, from Pleasantville, and we're also going to have Damon Tyner, the Atlantic County prosecutor, and the two same young men again, talking about the talk. And the talk is the conversation that older African-Americans have to have with young African-American men, mothers, grandmothers, aunts, uncles, grandfathers, about how to act when they engage with law enforcement so that they preserve their life. Very serious, intergenerational conversation that has been going on for too long. And we're going to have that November 19th from 1 to 2 p.m. It's going to be carried live on WEHA. It's going to be on the NAACP platforms, and that's going to be in conjunction with our friend and brother Perry Mays, the Coalition for a Safe Community. November 19th, that's a Thursday, 1 to 2 p.m. And it's going to be talking about the talk. And again, the talk is the unfortunate conversation that African-Americans of all economic classes have to have with their young men, and too often young women, but mostly young men, about how to deal with police so that they do not come away in a body bag. Unfortunate, but real. We're almost to 5 o'clock hour, and our guests today is my good friend and colleague, the esteemed Rabbi of Beth Israel Congregation in Northfield, Rabbi David Weis, who I'm honored to be a guest, as Yolanda's already said in her announcements, this Thursday at 7 o'clock for a Zoom panel that they're going to have emanating from Beth Israel's education classes. And we hope that you can tune into that. I hope it's going to be a very informed. I know it's going to be a very informative panel, and we're going to talk about in a very candid and respectful way what are our next steps, regardless of who becomes the next president, the next congressperson, the next senator from New Jersey, the next freeholder, even the next mayor of the city of Atlantic City. We have serious issues that we need to address, and we have to address. So, Yolanda, as we going to our tally, I think Rabbi Weis is our joint guest. Is that how we're doing it?
He's your longtime friend, but certainly is an esteemed member of our community, and he is a member of the NAACP. So we could share him because we are both members of the NAACP and we're leaders, but certainly I understand that longstanding commitment that you all have had for friendship, and I will defer to you as Rabbi Weis as your guest.
Okay, because I know I'm trying to, I don't know what our count is. Ladies and gentlemen, I had a friend of mine, he said he doesn't know who's keeping the count. So I will say that Rabbi Weis, is I'm honored to have you here. Yolanda is a co-host. We have a friendly competition about who has the whose guest is whose, but I was beat out when we had the Attorney General because Yolanda said that the Attorney General and her went to the same law school, so I couldn't compete with that. And then when we had the prosecutor, Prosecutor Tyner, she said her and Prosecutor Tyner went to the same undergraduate school, Howard University, so I couldn't compete with that. When we had Lieutenant Governor on, she had something else that she said, so I never win. So welcome to NAACP Speaks. Rabbi, thank you for taking your time to be our guest. We are honored and privileged to have you. And our format is Yolanda opens up with the guest bio and resume, and then we go from there. So over to you, Yolanda.
Good afternoon, Rabbi Weis.
Good afternoon. Thank you for having me.
So Rabbi David M. Weis, he brings a meaningful spirituality to the congregation at Beth Israel in Northfield. He's been a rabbi since 1988, serving generations of families as an extension of his own. Trained at Hebrew Union College, Rabbi Weis was ordained in 1983. He holds a Bachelor's of Arts degree from the University of California at Berkeley, a Master of Arts in Hebrew Letters from the Hebrew Union College Jewish Institute of Religion, California School, and on the occasion of the 25th anniversary of his ordination, Rabbi Weis received his Doctor of Divinity degree by the Hebrew Union College Jewish Institute of Religion. A lifelong learner and scholar, Rabbi Weis continues his studies each year by attending the Shalom Hartman Institute's Rabbinic Torah Study Seminar in Israel, and has achieved the academic honor of Senior Rabbinic Fellow of the Institute. He speaks in communities throughout the United States and has published essays and articles on a broad array of Jewish topics. He is an adjunct professor at Stockton University, a member of the Mainland Clergy Fellowship, and past president of the South Jersey Board of Rabbis and Cantors. Rabbi Weis is also active in interfaith education and dialogue. He teaches classes in Judaism at area churches, leads a Seder of Education at a local church each year, and is often invited to speak from the pulpits of area churches. Among his many honors is his induction to the prestigious Chapel of the Four Chaplains for his work in interfaith education and cooperation. In addition to his congregational family, Rabbi Weis's own children have grown up at Beth Israel. He is married to noted Judaic artist and educator, Susan Fisher Weis, who is the executive director of the Board of Jewish Education, as well as the leader of their youth groups at Beth Israel. They have three children, and he is no stranger to the NAACP, as we've mentioned before. He is a member of our branch. And so welcome, Rabbi Weis.
Thank you.
So the first question we always ask our guests is to tell us three things about you.
Three things about me. Well, I'm not a native to Atlantic County. Mm-hmm. However, as you mentioned, I've been living here since 1988, and I must say that I have lived here by a factor of three longer than I lived anywhere else in my life. So while I will eternally be a shubi, this is truly home, and I have grown to love and cherish this community, this part of the world, and the people who have so embraced me and my family. So that's one. Two, I would say one of the greatest honors that I've ever had was on the occasion of the 50th anniversary of Dr. King's very famous march across the Edmund Pettus Bridge. The National NAACP sponsored a march, a 40-day march from that bridge all the way to Washington, D.C. It was an incredibly powerful event, and my rabbinic colleagues and I determined that we were going to be part of that march. So my organization created a whole list of rabbis who agreed to march with the group. There was a small group that marched the entire journey, but there were people who came and joined them on a daily basis, either from the communities that they happen to be marching through or from guests. And so the rabbinic organization, the Central Conference of American Rabbis, had a sign-up sheet. And I had the honor of being able to be on that march for one of those days. And we had a Torah scroll, a scroll of the five books of Moses that in the Jewish community we use for ritual purposes inside the synagogue. It's a handwritten scroll of the five books of Moses. And we had a Torah scroll that made the entire journey. So there was an official handoff every evening from the outgoing rabbis to the incoming rabbis. So we carried that Torah on our march. And it was an incredibly powerful event in my life. I spent the entire evening, overnight, and the whole next day marching, carrying the Torah, singing with my brothers and sisters who were making the march. I marched 18 hours in the Alabama sun. And let me tell you, it is hot and humid in August down there, but I never felt more profound and more significant. In fact, I was walking and carrying the Torah, and then the president of the organization, he was walking next to me, and he said, Rabbi, don't get me wrong, we're thrilled that you all are here, but what are you doing here? Why are you doing this? And I reminded him that that 50 years earlier, there were rabbis who marched across that bridge with Dr. King. And I might have been much too young back then to make that march, but Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel spoke about his time walking across that bridge arm in arm with Dr. King. And he said, there are times when we pray with our souls, there are times when we pray with our words, and there are times when we pray with our feet. And it was important for me to join Dr. King and Rabbi Abraham Joshua Heschel and pray with my feet. There was an opportunity for us to stand up and talk about what is and what shouldn't be and what is right. And so that was one of the great honors of my life to be able to do that. And I will say the third piece that is part of that second piece. So we're in rural Alabama, and we all carry with us certain stereotypes and beliefs about people, which I fight against all the time, but it's hard not to keep those. And so here I am, I'm thinking, like, who's down there? These are all just backward redneck people, and I should be afraid of all of them. And I didn't find any of that. I mean, we were escorted by state troopers to make sure that we were protected, which is again something Dr. King didn't have. I mean, he was met with water hoses and attack dogs, so we felt safe. But there was one instant when we were marching down this little road in the middle of nowhere, and farms on either side of us, and I see a white farmer with a little tractor carrying a trailer behind him, a couple of hundred yards away from us. And then all of a sudden it starts barreling towards us. And I'm thinking, oh my God, what's going to happen here? And then he pulls up and jumps off his trailer, off his tractor, and his wife jumps off the tractor, and they grab a cooler from the back of the tractor and they open it up in front of us. And they say, we're so grateful that you're here and that you're doing this. And we just wanted to bring you some water. So I bring that up because there are times when we are reminded about our stereotypes and our beliefs about people. that and how wrong those can be, and how much we should not judge people by where they come from or how they dress or the color of their skin. But again, in the words of Dr. King, by the virtue of their character. And so in my own personal attempt to constantly grow in my own enlightenment, I was humbled and reminded that even those of us who think of ourselves as enlightened still have a long way to go.
Good. But listen, that leads me into my first question, Rabbi. Why did you think it was important to join the NAACP?
Well, so I probably don't need to tell you, and I certainly don't need to tell your listeners, but our country has been reminded in very stark and continual ways that the dream of the 60s, while certainly advancing human rights and civil rights in this country, hasn't yet been realized. Mm-hmm. And so during the shockwaves of COVID-19 and the one after the other reminders of what my brothers and sisters in the African American community endure every day, in city after city after town in America, I couldn't pretend that everything was okay, and I needed to make my voice heard. So it wasn't enough just to stand on the corner and scream, and it wasn't enough to attend events like so many that Kalim, you and I have attended together in response to events, no matter who's being persecuted or abused or attacked, we stand together. But sometimes we need to stand even independent of events. We can't always respond and react. Sometimes we need to be proactive. And so I wanted to add my name to the roster of those who stand up and say, if someone's rights are threatened, all our rights are threatened.
Thank you. And we appreciate your membership and support, Rabbi. Let me ask one more question before I turn over to Yolanda. I had the pleasure of hearing and seeing virtually your sermon on Yom Kippur. Can you tell the audience some of the points that you made in that sermon?
Yes. So I was privileged to be able to share it with you and honored that you actually took the time to watch it. It is so easy for people in my community to forget our own past, and to forget that several generations ago, Jews in America suffered from tremendous limitations due to anti-Semitism. That there were neighborhoods that were restricted, really restricted. Jews were not allowed in there. On the boardwalk in Atlantic City, there were many hotels that had signs, no Jews or dogs allowed. I mean, forget True. About black folk. They weren't even allowed to come onto the boardwalk, let alone, I don't have to tell you your history, but this was commonplace in American life that Jews had to live in their own neighborhoods. There were quotas at universities. There were There were significant limitations on their ability to move about freely and suffered greatly because of anti-Semitism. And really, anti-Semitism in America reached its zenith just prior to the Second World War. In the 20s and 30s in America, anti-Semitism was fairly widespread. And while most people weren't violent and you know didn't threaten anybody physically, they held on to those preconceived notions. And most Americans would not have called themselves anti-Semites. They would have said that I'm not an anti-Semite. I don't wish anybody any harm. I just don't want them in my neighborhoods. I don't want them in my schools. I don't want, you know, my kids don't have to play with them. I don't want them to stay in the same hotels or join the same clubs. It's not anti-Semitism. And I would of course say that when you judge an entire people because of some preconceived notion, that is racism. That's anti-Semitism. If you believe that all Jews are this, that, or the other, that's anti-Semitism. And racism is exactly the same. It's too easy for us to think that all Black folk are the same and dangerous because some Black folk are. You know, nobody ever says about white people that do terrible things, like, oh my God, the whole white people is somehow evil, because tainted because of this guy. But we regularly think that about Black people. And I wanted my people to know that you can't be opposed to anti-Semitism and still hold stereotypes about Black folk. So I made the comparison between what we're experiencing as a nation now, and in particular, because people excuse the horrors of racial profiling and police brutality and systemic racism in America and its institutions because of the reactions of some people. The marches that we saw this spring and this summer were incredibly heartening in a lot of ways. I mean, one of the things that we couldn't help but notice is that this wasn't just Black folk, it wasn't just brown folk, that there were Black, brown, white, and yellow, I mean, Asians, I mean, young and old. This was America taking to the streets saying, America needs to be better than this. And then too many people fall back on the fact that these peaceful protests that were righteous and profound and powerful, people would look to the handful, literally relative to the numbers of people who protested, the handful of rioters and looters and disruptors, and then allow themselves to say, well, yes, that's wrong, but look at this, and then excuse it. So I needed to say, I don't condone violence. I don't condone riots. I don't condone looting, but to dismiss the entire Black Lives Matters movement because of the poor actions of some is horrific and wrong spirited. Any more than all of the Jews are to blame for the actions of some who might be amoral or immoral or criminal.
Very powerful, Rabbi. Thank you. And I am listening. I might steal some of your comments from your sermon, so I'll give you credit, though. when I do that. Yolanda, you have a question for Rabbi Weis?
Absolutely. So Rabbi Weis, as you were talking, I was just kind of thinking about the relationship between African-Americans and civil rights and the Jewish community. And I just want to acknowledge for those who don't know and have that history lesson, don't have that history lesson, that the NAACP is steeped in relationship with the Jewish community from Joel Spingarn. So we have this penultimate medal or of honor that's given at the end of the NAACP. He was a Jewish activist who believed in civil rights, and his commitment to the NAACP is found in us giving the highest honor of our convention to someone in our community who has done something over the past year. Many don't know that it was the members of the Jewish community who were the lawyers who were able to bail out civil rights activists who were imprisoned or were inviting them to their coffee tables to have conversations about voting rights and brutality and how to make African-Americans in the 60s just be considered human beings. And that gets lost in the conversations. But what we do as two communities understand is that vitriolic hate is still prevalent. And when people talk about racism and being xenophobic and doing things against America, the first two people who are targeted are often African-Americans and members of the Jewish community. Mm-hmm. So with that perspective, I want to know your perspective on Black and Jewish relations.
So it hasn't been perhaps as prevalent in recent years, but the partnership between the Black community and the Jewish community has always been profound. There is a museum to the civil rights movement, actually to those who died in the civil rights movement. There's a memorial, and I visited that memorial right before I went on my march. I wanted to pay tribute to those heroes who literally gave their lives for justice and righteousness and equality in America. And those people who were murdered because they fought for civil rights were on the walls of this museum at this memorial. And amongst those mostly African-Americans, there were three Jewish men as well, because there were Jews who got on buses and went into the South and marched with African Americans and marched and engaged in voter registration drives. And three of them were killed because they fought for justice. And it is still true today, although in some ways, you know, that partnership has faded. When Kaleem asked me, you know, why I joined the NAACP again, one of the reasons is that that we are natural allies in the fight for justice and the fight against racism. The Anti-Defamation League, the ADL, is not just an organization that fights for Jewish rights. There are no such thing as Jewish rights. There are only civil rights. There are only human rights. Right. And it may have been founded to fight for those rights for Jews, but it stands tall and vigilant to fight for those rights for everyone. Because again, until all are free, none are truly free. So my relationship with the African American community is pretty significant. I try to attend as often as I can, but I will tell you, over the years, I've developed one relationship in particular with the folks at New Hope Baptist Church and
Reverend Pastor Howard.
Yeah, a dear friend of mine, and I up until March. I go to church. I have over the last many years. gone to that church a number of times a year, and was honored to speak from that pulpit on a number of occasions, and the people there know that that New Hope is my church. I mean, that's where I go when I go to church, I'm in awe of you know what the Howards have achieved there, and what the members of that community have achieved in their neighborhood, I'm honored to be partners with them on a number of occasions. The unfortunate reality is that I haven't been able to be there in all these months, but in truth, you know, I haven't been able to be with my own people very much either. So,
okay. Rabbi, listen, we are coming to the end of our time. It's went so fast. There's only 5 minutes left. If Yolanda doesn't have another question, we're going to ask you to make closing remarks. And we're also we already in the first half talked about Thursday, where you're going to have your discussion about racism in America, which I'm honored to be a guest along with Bill Subin. And we wanted to invite people to tune in at 7 o'clock for that.
You'll be distributing the Zoom link to everyone so that they'll be able to join us?
Yes, we're going to. How are we going to do that, Yolanda?
We will put it on all of our social media platforms, and we'll mail it out to our membership as well.
Great. Okay. We've been having a series of ongoing meetings within my congregation in our adult community. On the issue of racism, and we need to move beyond talking about it. We need to move beyond information about it, and we need to create opportunities to be activists. The great realization is it's not enough to not be a racist.
Right.
If you're not an anti-racist, if you're not actively fighting against racism, that's precisely what the system hopes you'll do. Mm-hmm. It's not that evil people are more evil than they used to be. It's that too many of us who aren't evil don't confront it. I think one of the things that we're seeing in this tumultuous time is that people are actually beginning to become afraid because they are seeing their privilege threatened. One of the things that I spoke about in my sermon is I'm not taking away anything from people who have worked hard to achieve greatness. Mm-hmm. I've worked hard to achieve what I've achieved in my life. But if I don't recognize that my road has been smoother, then I will not be activist in making sure that we repair the roads. We need to repair the roads.
Rabbi, I can't think of a better way to close. It has been our distinct pleasure to have you as our guest today at the NAACP election special edition. We thank you. We look forward to meeting with you Thursday on the Zoom. And as Yolanda said, we're going to make sure that all our membership gets the Zoom credentials, and we'll put it on our platform. Yolanda, closing remarks.
I just want to thank you again, Rabbi Weis. This was a masterclass on how we can be better allies and better humans, and of course, being anti-racist. So thank you for putting all this information out. This is a continued conversation.
Also, I just want to mention the ADL and the NAACP on the national level, the state level, and here locally has a partnership. We are working actively with the ADL. So I think, Rabbi, what we're doing is building some of those bonds back again. It's 5:30. Let me say, everyone be safe. See you again next week. When we fight, we win. When we fight, we win. When we fight, we win. Rabbi, see you Thursday.